got everything done.
I hope you got everything done. Everything. So now here we come to the dialogue part, and we're going to stop at exactly 4:25. No, 5:25. What is it? 5:25, not 5:26. So if you have questions about your work and your creative process, ask. And I'll keep the answers really fast, but not, you know, unhelpful. Sorry, I like children. Do you have a question, or are you just like playing with your pencil? You just like... Yeah, Adam.
So if one is writing something and one is having a problem like with a scene that like they wrote and finished earlier, and it's like, but the whole piece isn't finished, would you recommend like taking the time, and I mean like this earlier section is like driving the writer crazy. Would you recommend just going back and revising it just to not be crazy, even though it's not finished, or would you recommend like just going through and finishing the piece and then coming?
What do you think I was saying?
Finish the piece.
Yeah, so Adam's like, yo, so he's written, you know, Adam comes, like, he's a regular. So he comes. So so this week Adam's asking if one is writing a piece and a scene before, sorry to make your business loud like that, but the scene before is, you know, you've written scene 2, and now you're on scene 12, and scene 2 is driving you crazy. Should you stop, go back to scene 2 so that you can make scene 2 perfect? Or should you go on to the end and then go back and rewrite? And it's a joke, right? It's a joke question. You can try to see, like, what am I saying? Like, maybe this week she'll say, go back and fix it. No.
I had a feeling I knew what you'd say, but I just wanted to.
Come here. I would say, go forward. Go forward. Adam West, go west, go, keep going to the end, because then you're really going to know what that scene should be. Right now, it's driving you crazy, probably because, one, you're already crazy, two, and you don't have that far to go, two, you're nervous, because we all are when we're working on things, right? We're all nervous. I'm nervous anyway, I'm nervous, because you think, like, maybe I'll never get it done, maybe it'll never be any good, all those concerns we have, and three, I don't know the third one, but... All those reasons are making you want to go back and make something perfect. And we talked about perfection, it's the desire of a smaller mind. Right, so forget being perfect, just get done. You can make it better later. It's a mirage. You know, have you ever been like, have seen a mirage? You know, or it's like a bad like boyfriend or girlfriend. Oh, I should have been with him. I'll go back and call him. And I'm working out, please.
This is gonna make me sound even more crazy, but like, how do you kind of put down the voices that are saying, like, go back?
And no, because they're there, right? And they're talking to you, and they're saying, come on, Adam. Like Lot's wife. Just look at me, man.
So
you know
how
want
you,
to.
How do you move beyond that?
Say, you know, sister, talk to the hand, you know? Like Indiana Jones and the Temple of whatever, the first one. We had to close his eyes. Whatever it's called. Thank you. Okay. Yeah, Raiders, right? And he, you know, they said, keep your eyes closed when you open the box. And all the people were like, hey, but he was smart, which is why he's now in this new Star Wars. He kept his eyes closed and all the demons were looking at him. He just like, I will not be tempted. Actually, there's a more beautiful thing tempting you, and you can't see the beauty of that thing. It's the end of your play, and it calls to you in a small voice. You have to listen to that small voice.
I guess that was my real question, I guess.
Yeah, how do you just not listen to that, you know, or say, look, I'll deal with you when I'm done. Yeah, yes.
And yet allow it. I'm having difficulty with reality.
Okay.
My character.
version, the here and now, the tangible, as opposed to the psychological. How do you as a writer find a way to keep the audience engaged in the psychological reality for theater in a way that keeps the story moving forward and yet honors the story of the mental world? Okay, so my characters are fantasy people. They like to run off into fantasy because
Your characters are
like to
characters
to
who enjoy
fantasy
right. world. Okay.
Because the reality of the world around them is a bit much.
Right.
How do you find a way to keep the audience in a proscenium stage or even a black box engaged when those worlds keep on intersecting and jumping in a way that's effective for the audience, not just effective for the character?
Right, so this is true for maybe everything, maybe. It's a unifying theory of, I don't know, I'm just making shit up right now, but you invest it with urgency and stakes.
That's sufficient. Even if the storyline is completely deviating.
Sure,
from, yeah.
sure, that's called the, what is it? I mean, sure, there are, I mean, for you, for example, think of Hamlet, for example, right? The play.
Yeah.
Okay, right. You know kind of the story
yeah,
of the play.
Yeah,
okay, right. I know. Where is this going? I don't know. I'm not sure either. But think of Hamlet. So what if Hamlet, you know, he has a mental problem. What if he thought...
But it's not a mental problem.
Well, this is, he enjoyed to think of other things, we could say. What if he thought he was, say, a grave digger, really? What I'm saying is every time we cut to the grave digger, we're seeing a storyline with stakes. What I'm saying is invest the storyline with stakes. Invest, so you have character A, right? And he likes to imagine himself as character B flat. The life of character B flat must have stakes.
And the stakes have to contribute to the stakes of the reality world.
That would be best, actually. That's how Shakespeare did it. Yeah, I mean, it was like connected, you know what I'm saying? Like, alas, poor Yorick, yo, you're dead, I don't know. His lips, whatever he's saying. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, so it contributed. It had something to do with character A. That's like the best. Or you can just have them running, you know, parallel tracks or something like that, okay? But that's the best when they contribute somehow, or A is contributing to the story of B flat somehow. A choice that A makes.
But is it a cop out if the fantasy world informs the present world? Is it a cop out for him not to actively make choices that allow the fantasy world to be sparking the choices?
Well, if the fantasy world is an extension of their own mind, then it's not a cop out. It's not. But how much of it have you written?
90%.
Okay, good. So you just have like how many more pages? Great, so just finish it and then see. I mean, you got it mostly done.
Right.
So, great. Not a cop out. I mean, cop out. That's such a, I don't know, you wrote like 90 pages, 100 pages, 120 pages.
See, the wonder of film is the audience knows that they're being taken to another realm and they accept it. But
the audience knows what?
The audience is given this visual that says, yes, this is not real.
I don't know. Really? I don't know. Like Fight Club? Did you know Tyler Durden wasn't real until he was like not real? No, I thought he was really Brad Pitt with some other gloves. I was like, nope. I was sold on it. And then, oh no, it's just part of the and you're dead. I don't know.
What do you think about
Suzan-Lori
Parks?
Who? Suzan-Lori
Parks.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yes. Hi. Oh, good.
Hello. So, when oneself in her process comes across censoring herself, myself.
Yes.
I am being challenged with that because I'm writing for myself. I see myself as the one performing it, and so I'm not allowing myself to, because I can, the character is so far from myself, that I'm censoring myself, and I know it. How can I stop myself from censoring myself? Like, the stuff that's coming on the paper is just so, like, whoa, or am I really gonna get there and say that? But I think it needs to be said, but I feel like the work is, I'm giving the work injustice because I see myself up there saying these things and anticipate reaction. And so I feel like my piece is struggling because of that. Or should I just take away the fact that I'm thinking, should I convince myself that someone else will do the work and they can say it and then finish it like, nope, I'm gonna do it. Or
if you can believe that,
yeah.
You know what I mean? If you can trick yourself into believing that, that's a great way to do it. To say, I'm writing this for someone else, and tell those voices in your head that are trying to shut you down, it's not going to be me, it's going to be somebody else. Do that. Another thing is to write fast. We talked about the sensor. The sensor is really slow and uses a walker. And they're really shrewish. Their voice penetrates, you know, your quietest moment, but they're really slow. They're not elderly, they're just slow. Thoughts. You know what I mean? So you can get by the sensor by writing very quickly. That's another helpful thing too. But yeah, you can tell yourself that someone else is going to perform it. You can actually, I don't know, call up a friend and say, this is actually, I'm writing something for you. I don't know how deep you got to get into the land of make-believe to get your work done. You can just also say, like, if you'll have, talk to the hand. Just talk to them, like, shut them down. Like, imagine there's someone talking to you. Oh, I don't know what people are going to think, but just, you know, I don't know what kind of language you're comfortable with, but, you know.
Yeah. Shut the fuck up, bitch.
Yeah. That's the stuff that's ending up on the paper.
Okay, good. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah. You know, excuse me, I'm writing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. You can think, well, I'm sorry. I'm
serious.
They're serious. Yeah, I know. I just said, oh, God forbid.
Yeah.
And just keep writing, like, keep showing up every day. You will weaken the resolve of that censor, who is very helpful, but not now. She or he is really good when you're doing rewrites, but not now.
Good. Thank you. Anybody else?
Yes.
Hi.
Good to see you again.
Good to see you. What happens when you, what do you do when you've sort of fallen out of love with an idea?
Well, what are you thinking, like, are you in the middle of writing it, or?
Yeah, I'm about, like, 30 pages in, and I don't love it. And I did love it, and I don't love it.
So, well, they're different, so it's like dating, yeah. Or marriage.
So well, those are very different.
Well, there's a moment in every relationship where you go, am I really going to stay with you? Because you, like, I don't know, don't wash your socks every day or some weird thing. You know what I mean? You have to, or you have to say, do I really not want to be with this project, or am I scared? My guess is that you're scared. I'm just guessing. Something about it is scary. Something about it. So we have, or you don't love it and that's easy, you just cut it off. But if you're scared, then it becomes interesting because then we have something to work with, right?
I think the situation is that it's just feeling very like routine. Feeling like, oh, I gotta wake up today and write that scene.
Yeah, boredom is a way that we mask fear. Oh, I don't know. He's so bored. Like, you're like, oh, I don't know. He's so bored. He never takes me to the Eiffel Tower. You know what I'm saying? You know, I mean, really, boredom is a way that we mask fear. That's just so you know. And whether you are really bored or scared, I don't know. But I would say everything you're feeling, just entertain the possibility that maybe everything you're feeling, because you're a really good writer, because I know you. Yes, you are. And so maybe you're just scared. There's something there that frightens you. So if you're truly bored, you have enough craft. You have a high level of craft as a writer. You can just keep on keeping on and get
the shit done.
Right? Get the stuff done. Get to page, what? How many pages? 120, 90, what is it?
120.
Okay, where are you now? You're on like
30, 40.
Good. Make a deadline for yourself and just get the stuff done. Just get the pages done.
Just
and then
push through the boredom.
And I'm bored, so what?
Because then you have to learn something else. That, hey, even if you're bored, what does Joyce Carol say when my soul is as thin as a playing card? And she's great. She's right, girl. Okay, you know. Girl puts out, big time, right? So when my soul is as thin as a playing card, somehow writing makes it better. That's a horrible paraphrase of her brilliant quote. But she shows up regardless of her mood and gets the writing done. Mm-hmm. So I'm sure there have been many times where she's been bored, right?
But the boredom is a natural thing. That's not like the world's worst sign. It could be fine.
No, it could be fine. And sometimes we have work for hires that we do.
Maybe it's like that. And sometimes, yeah, we're bored. Sometimes we fucking hate the producers. Ah, I hate the producers. So what?
I'm going to do it anyway, because then you are becoming a professional. And that's what we want to become. Regardless of how much money we get paid, we're becoming professionals. This is your calling.
What?
This is your calling. Hello? It's calling to you. Come on. Pass the boredom. Pass the fear. Pass the, oh, I don't know if this is a good idea. Pass the, oh, I maybe I better fix the second scene and get it perfect. Your calling is calling to you.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I'm so glad you're here.
Hey!
Hi! So I'm working on Play for Class right now.
Yeah.
And I don't know what it's about. And I'm wondering, how do you figure out what the play is about when you have a lot of good characters and conflict, but at the end you're like, now what am I writing?
What does that mean exactly? What am I writing about? What does that mean? What am I writing about? I mean, what the play is about? What does that actually mean? Like what the story is?
Yeah, what the story is, or am I saying anything, or am I just got a lot of characters that are just confused?
I'm making faces because I'm not on camera. Am I saying anything? Lord have mercy. I don't know if I've ever said anything. I don't even think about what I'm saying. You know, I mean, I think about what I'm saying right now, we're talking, but in a, like a play, what is Suzan-Lori Parks saying? I don't fucking know. I don't fucking care. I don't, but I'll tell you what the story's about. I can tell you the story.
Okay.
So, because I stay on the level of story, and I leave meaning and all those important aspects to the scholars and the literary critics and the people who read my play. That's not for me to know. It's a need to know basis, and I don't need to know to write the story.
Okay.
Okay, so here you are saying, what's my story about? Now we're talking about something you can do something about.
Okay.
Once upon a time, there was a woman who
was in the army.
Was in the army and but
she got out.
And she got out. Okay.
Yeah, that helps.
And some things happened along the way?
Yeah.
Okay, tell me the story. Leave the what is it about and the themes and the place in cultural history and all those important things that are spoken about once your play is up and running and all that. Leave that to the scholars. It's not, I feel, it's not, you don't need to know that to write your play.
Okay, good.
Okay, yeah, you're free. You're free. Hallelujah. Okay.
That was helpful.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. It's good to see you. I'm sorry you're not in my class this semester. It was fun having you in class last semester.
I'll hear them.
Okay, you come visit us at Washington.
Okay.
Oh, well, this is good. You're good.
I'm just from Texas. If any of you wondered. She's from Texas.
Every week.
Every week you're
every
from
week.
Texas.
Okay.
Hi, I'm one of Carol's students at NYU. Nice to meet you. What's your feeling? I do a lot of time writing.
Yes.
At home, turn everything off. Put the phone on the moon, do not disturb, turn everything off for 20-minute increments at a time, sometimes 30. What do you think the next step is? Do you go to 45 minutes, or is it like exercise building up slowly? Because that's, to me, the most magical time when everything is off.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, so if you can, that's a great question. Everybody hear that
time thing,
20 minutes? I think 20 minutes is a really magical amount of time. And if, I don't know, your other things you got going on in your life, but it's
a lot.
Okay, so 20 minutes. So if you can have 20 minutes here, there, then you can add it up at the end of the day, and you got like an hour done, and you got whatever, 2 hours done, whatever you can do. Sometimes it's hard for us with a lot going on to manage 3 hours. There's nothing holy about 3 hours or an hour. Okay, the most important thing is what you're doing right now. Setting the time, setting your timer. Putting your phone, as you said beautifully, on the moon. Okay? I would suggest, yeah, so then that, I would suggest that when we use a timer, I didn't use one today because I forgot mine, but usually I use a regular egg timer, like a kitchen timer, and not your phone, because as I said, your phone is crack. So sometimes crack is great.
Oh. Sorry. No, she needs to hear this.
Yeah, crack is really, crack is whack, and it's true. Crack is really bad, but I was making a joke. Anyway.
Oh,
you in the phone?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, your phone is cracked.
Yes.
It looks like it's really wonderful and it's the gateway to the entire universe. It's not.
The universe, the gateway of the universe is right here. That small still voice within, that thing you were born with, that your mom and dad gave you, you got it already. The phone isn't gonna really help you, except if you need to know the meaning of a word like sui generis, and then you can look it up on your phone. But so 20 minutes often is great. Is great. If you want to do an hour block or something like that, cool. But that doesn't, I do 20 minute blocks. I got a lot going on too. So if I want to do, for example, I told people I drop off my son at daycare, and then I come home and I do like 20 minutes of songwriting. Miraculously, that stuff actually works. I've gotten so much stuff done with little 20 minute blocks. Okay?
Thank you.
Sure, thank you. Where are you from again in Texas?
I feel like Dallas, Texas, but I feel like next week I'm going to say I'm actually from Florida, just to mix it up a little. Because every week you say I'm from Texas.
Well, that's because it's true.
It is true.
Okay.
Go Texas.
Yeah, go Texas. It gives us a chance to say go Texas. Ooh, go to Lawrence. Okay.
Who's next? Nobody. Oh, we have, oh, yes.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi there. You have great hair.
Oh, thank you. So I'm sort of between projects.
Yes.
I have a play that I'm in between drafts.
Right.
And I feel like I want to start something new. I have a box full of ideas, and
right.
I hate them all.
Oh.
And so I kind of like, what do you do when you're stuck? I feel like in my writing, I sort of reached a level where I needed to be better, so I don't want to start all these ideas that are,
right.
You know.
Right.
How do you sort of reach over that next step of challenge, I suppose?
Right, I something fell off the wall, and my eyes wandered from your face, I'm sorry. But that's a really good question. So if you have a box of ideas and you haven't started anything yet, and you just look at them and you think, well, I came up with these ideas when I was in a different place. Sounds like you're in a different place now, and you want to start something new. You can just take your notebook simply and write out, here are some fun ideas for plays, for example. Here's some fun ideas. I always wanted to write a play about, or here's 10 stupid ideas for plays, and write those out. That works too. Sometimes you let yourself off the hook a little bit. You know, you can do that. I would say that, yeah, don't, if you really feel like before you even open the box, I don't like any of those, great, fine. Don't look at them. Maybe come back to them at another time, or burn the box. If you're not gonna use it, you know, you don't want it to take up space in your life. You know, but if you kind of think maybe one day you might come in, okay, yeah, I mean, you might think, you know, then you can keep them for another day. But does that sound helpful? Just
can't or not?
No. Something else. You need something else, right? Like you're in between projects, so you're feeling like I'm waiting. What are you waiting on for the rewrite?
Oh, no, I do have to do it. It's just I'm waiting for the director to read and get back to me.
So
I have time.
That's great.
Which is nice.
That's really, really great.
Yeah,
that's
so I just
commercial.
Feel like I want to sort of fill this gap with something.
What do you want to write about?
Yeah.
What? I bet you know. What do you want to write about? Just pretend like you know right now. Just for fun.
I know, something political and urgent.
Good, political and urgent. What's the main character look like? What is it, a man or a woman?
Probably a woman.
Probably a woman, right. And is she like of this country or what country? Where is she?
Well, I live in Australia.
Okay.
And so she's probably not from there.
Okay. So she's from somewhere other than Australia.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Does she have kids or no? Or is she?
Well, she might. Yeah, I think she might.
Uh-huh. Okay. And is she like running for office or not? Or?
That's a good idea.
I mean, I'm just saying. Well, you see, she's running for office.
Yeah.
So maybe your next play can be an urgent play about a woman running for office in a place other than Australia.
Cool.
So you like that, right? Okay. See how easy it is. Sometimes you just have to pretend like you know. Because the actual reality is you actually do, and what we do a lot of times is do this, we tell them, I don't know, like that. And if you really just pretend, like in American football, which is a game that you don't want to play, either of you, don't, good, American football. But anyway, I mean, no sweat, people love that, anyway, but you know what I'm talking about. But the guy, you know, when they're trying to make the touchdown, and they can't, right? And they call out the kicker and they punt. So all you do is just kick the fucking ball. Like that. Yeah, hey, yay. You made a goal or whatever. A touchdown, whatever it's called. Well, field goal.
But there's that fear, isn't there, that there's not that much time left.
Do you know what I mean?
Well, we're all getting older, right? So you don't want to spend, it's like page 30, and they're like, and you know, am I wasting my time? I mean, you don't want to kind of go,
there's
I'm
another voice.
Write a whole play.
But we each have these voices. This is, scene two isn't any good. I'm bored with my project. Time is moving along, we're all getting older, you don't want to waste your time. I don't know what the audiences think. It's all the same voice that's trying to shut you up. That's all it is. It's just clutter in your mind. And depending on who you are and where you are in your life and career, your voice is going to say things. So if you're 20, maybe it's not I'm getting old, but it's do I matter? You know? Maybe when you're 40, it's I'm getting old. I mean, it's like a relative at one of those holidays, and you're just like, you know what I'm saying? You just get up from the table and you just, we have to learn that that's all it is. It's just that mental, it's vritti, what they call, we call in yoga vritti, clutter, just the chatter of the mind. And no matter who you are, where you are, we all have it. And what we have to do is work in spite of it. It's not that we're going to try to shut it down forever or whatever, because it's useful for some things. 5 minutes, we have 5 minutes.
We have time for one more quick question.
Or a really quick answer. Yes. No. Yes. Hi. You.
Who's asking for that?
Hey, Merle. Thank you for...
Good to see you.
Hey, good to see you.
Hi.
Quick question.
Yes.
So how important is it for you to hear your work read out loud by actors? And at what stage do you feel comfortable doing that? And also, how important is it for you to hear it in front of an audience? And do you make big changes based on...
I think audience is really important. We love audiences.
I'm not on camera.
And I think actors are really important too. So this is the thing, going back to square one. As a writer, and I know you're a very good playwright, because I know because I had your class this semester, but what we need to know is that you can hear your work already. The idea, the thing that we're taught in some institutions, not in my class at NYU, but maybe someone has heard somewhere, that you can't hear your work unless you have actors read it. And that is not true. The truth is that you can hear your work already. You're a composer, like, you know, Coltrane, or Mozart, or Bach. You know, they can hear it in their head. Actors are expert amplifiers. They're speakers. Ah, now I can hear it in full color sound. You know what I'm saying? Because they're actors. They're brilliant and fabulous. So they're useful, but I don't give my work to actors until I'm really solid with it on the page. Okay? Then I give it to them, and yeah, I can hear, ooh, that doesn't sound right, that's a little long, that ties the tongue up in a way that's not helpful, that's confusing, because these expert speakers are speaking it, so I make changes. In front of audiences, I might make more changes, but not because, like, ooh, they like that part, they don't like that part. So I'm not, you know, doing focus groups with my work, With work for hire, sometimes, yeah, there are focus groups, and that's, you know, what happens. One more? No? We gotta wrap it up. So can we, do we stay or we go? Or it's confusing. We're like at the mercy of the...
Well, we do have another event happening downstairs.
We have another event happening downstairs.
At 5:30.
Great, okay.
We should talk about next week.
Okay, yes, next
we're
week.
Not here.
Yes, next week. Go, tell them.
Okay, so... Thank you to everybody who came out tonight. This was really, really awesome. So to next week, we are not having Watch Me Work because SLP is out of town.
I'm opening Father Comes Home from the Wars at
Center Theater Group.
That's right. Congratulations.
They're doing a great job. So
if you're out in LA, go see it. But we will be back April 25th, same at our regular time at 5 o'clock. Thanks to everybody who tuned in at 4:30 today. But we will see you in 2 weeks at 5 o'clock.
Okay, bye. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, everybody, for coming out. We have to start tearing down. So.